Ready to face your fears head on, conquer them, and create a safer, more prosperous future? Worried that the world has gone f***ing nuts and you've become an insanity magnet? Then grab a cold libation, put on your fuzzy slippers, and get ready to create your own safe space. It's the Safe Space Podcast with your host, Tammy D. For more information and episodes, go to www.saferpodcast.com. That's www.saferpodcast.com.
Good morning, everybody. This is Tammy DeLue, and this is the Safe Space Podcast, where you meet interesting people in all walks of life. I really gravitate toward the entrepreneurs, and I'm happy today to have someone who I've, you know, at least known about since he was probably 12 years old, been following this gentleman's journey and growing up, you know, in an unusual environment with Teresa Kuhn, the on fire entrepreneur. So we've got Keating Kuhn here today. Hello, Keating. How's it going?
Hello. Good. How are you?
Yeah, I'm doing fine. And you're talking to us today from lovely Austin, Texas, the woke capital of Texas.
Indeed.
Yay. Indeed. So the reason I had Keating on is because his mom and I have known each other for quite some time now. And she is, everybody knows Teresa now. I've made her famous. You know that. You know? I've made her famous because she's, every advisor wants to be Teresa. Every male advisor wants to date Teresa. So I thought I'd bring Teresa's pride and joy, her one and only Keating, on to talk about his journey and how he decided to kind of buck the traditional, let's finish high school, go to college, get a four-year degree in something that you may never, ever, ever do and incur a lot of debt. And I was always curious as to what you would do, Keating, because I know that your mom wanted you to go to school because she's a nerd and she thinks a lot of education. But I wanted you to talk a little bit, first of all, who you are, what you're doing right now, and then tell us a little bit about the story of how you approached, I'm sure with a lot of trepidation, approached Teresa and said, Mom, I really don't think I'm college material. I don't really want to do this. I want to do something else.
So. Certainly. Yeah, certainly. I think a certain amount of it was a family decision, right? You know, going into a trade, there's a certain amount of knowledge base that has to come first. You know, my journey for the first couple of years really learning from big companies and learning how to break things, I think, was very important just for my own knowledge sake. Growing up with an entrepreneur in the house and, you know, a father who was very smart in his field of electrical engineering, you know, growing up as an only child and growing up around adults, you know, they would take me to either their office or different events to where I was around smarter people than I had at a very early age.
We didn't really tell them that you do HVAC. So get in, tell us too, how you picked that after you, I mean, you grew up around Teresa and I'm sure she was really excited that you're going to be an entrepreneur, but tell us a little bit about how you picked this particular field. Explain a little bit. So you grew up in that household, you grew up with people who are motivated type A people. So what happened next?
Yeah, the thought process of a dying industry had come across, I think, all of our minds in many different ways, right? And the fact that, you know, the internet spurs on a certain amount of change. And when you look at, you know, fast food restaurants and the fact that, you know, they're going to start to shift away from employees as much as possible. One of the things that we realize that cannot be done just with technology is the trades, at least a lot of the trades. Some functions and portions of trades can be shifted into using technology, but you're always going to need that hands-on person to go and fix things. So that was a conversation that, you know, we had at least for a couple of years. I think, you know, part of my journey going to Singularity University really opened my eyes in that fact too, right? That was a quote unquote university. It was a 5-week course. They had a 10-week course for a little bit older people than myself. But I learned so much from that at you know, 18 years old. And, you know, growing up with a mother who researched endlessly, you know, there was always a background of my knowledge base that came from just my own research. And so, you know, I think knowing that I could have a certain amount of information come to me that wasn't force fed, that I can go find that information if it's what I want to look for. A certain amount of that, you know, came at the, you know, critical stages of my life. Then realizing, you know, like you said, the debt. you know, the fact that my health was already not at a great point, just from, you know, a few different things that I had going on, you know, later in high school, realizing that, you know, the party atmosphere that a college brings wouldn't favor me in the long term. And really, I had been working in a restaurant for 2 years while I was going to high school. You know, I was working 35, 40 hours a week in high school. And so I already had a work ethic. You know, going into the trade was just a part of that journey. You know, certainly the decision was made that, you know, college, if I want a college experience, I can always have that at 30, 40 years old, you know, after I've become self-made, and it would be on my terms and not necessarily on those type of terms. But, you know, really the decision was made that, you know, maybe college isn't the best route to learn business. If I wanted to learn business or entrepreneurship, I can go do my own thing. And my overarching question, you know, during those critical years was, what am I going to do, right? What is my passion? And so, you know, obviously I like being around people. I enjoy talking with different people every day, but I also like getting my hands dirty, and I like to experience, you know, going into some place that you don't know what's wrong and fixing something. So that was a fairly easy transition into the HVAC world. And so, you know, 2 years, roughly 2 years of shadowing or being a new guy in the HVAC world, learning enough to, you know, be the one and only technician starting Gold Eagle, it certainly gave me a leg up on, you know, knowing that I had two parents that were, you know, right next to me, at least in the beginning stages, to kind of spur on that journey and start to develop my business mind, as well as the sales mind and the working mind of a HVAC technician.
Did they already kind of know that you probably weren't going to thrive in a college environment, or were they a little disappointed, or how did you spin it so it was a good thing for them, you know?
I certainly think they were aware that my study habits were not congruent with a college level sort of education. You know, I had tried online school for 6 months and quickly realized that if I was going to do the college life, that it wasn't going to be online, right? I'm a fairly social person, and that just wasn't cutting it. So yeah, I think it was a family conversation, right? Or many conversations as a family that, you know, ended up, you know, just going through this process.
You know, I was kind of in on the beginning when you first started this. It's an interesting business, especially there in Texas, where you have extreme weather. You know, there was snowmageddon. There was, I mean, there's just everything there. You know, nature throws you curveballs all the time there. And so it was an interesting choice of businesses. Is it hard for you being in a college town, being around that environment? You know, when you meet people and they ask you what you do, or they assume that you're at University of Texas or whatever, or a grad student or whatever, you know, what is it that you tell people that your, you know, your vision is?
I wouldn't say it's difficult to be in a college town or around a college town. I would say that, you know, since a lot of my friends were at that college age when we started the company, you know, I was still able to partake in bits and pieces, you know, not to the extent that they were, obviously, but I also didn't have a lot of the bad habits maybe that they developed through the college years. Most of the time when, you know, either I'm out and about or meeting people, college questions do come up. The conversation, at least in my point of view, right, it shifts fairly quickly once they know, okay, well, you know, I've especially at the 5 year point now, it's easy to say, well, I've owned my own business for 5 years. So that conversation does shift a little bit easier now. I would say at the beginning it was a little bit difficult, right? Everyone's either saying I went to Texas or I went to A&M or, you know, obviously the Dukes or the UCLAs of the world, you know, and maybe there was a little bit of jealousy, or, you know, there was just something in my head that, you know, made me think, okay, maybe I'm missing out on something, or maybe I missed out on something. But at this point, I feel like I've gotten more of a college education than I could have in a business school, right? Real life learning, at least in my mind, especially 5 years of business learning has taught me.
Much more practical. You have experience. You have what employers really would want, which is you can do something.
And it didn't come with the debt, right? I was making money that whole time.
And speaking of that, okay, so an interesting thing is that Teresa had in place, Teresa and David had in place plans for you. In other words, they had some financing options. So can you explain how, okay, once you decided that you're going to do HVAC, once you decided, you know, sort of a model for your company, What was the process now of financing this, and how, I've heard a lot of things that you own a bunch of houses, that you're a tycoon, you're going to be on, you're going to be on Shark Tank one day. I don't know, but tell me how that came about. How did they make it easier for you to own this business?
I think once those few years had passed, the seeing the work ethic that I had, right? The first refrigeration company that I worked for, there were 70, 80, 90-hour weeks with them. And that was for a year and a half period. The second company that I worked for, I had a very strict colleague. He was definitely my immediate boss, and he would make sure that I was on time to our location at 4 a.m. And if I was a couple minutes late, he would make me drive the rest of the way instead of utilizing the company vehicle. And so that work ethic and getting up at 4 o'clock in the morning every day, Monday through Friday, it makes your social life a little difficult, right? Because your bedtime is now 7 p.m., 8 p.m. Even on the weekends, if I wanted to go out Friday and Saturday night, I knew that Sunday was going to be a little bit more difficult, or I wasn't able to keep up with my friends on Friday and Saturday night. I was starting to get drowsy, around that 10 p.m. mark when their party is just starting. So I think once they saw that drive, and obviously the willingness to get up and go do what's necessary to drive a business, I think that at least put some of their concerns at ease. And so, once we bought that first truck, once we spent money on marketing or a website or the logo and the branding design, that all came from the nest egg that they had for me to go to college. And so, it was still a large chunk of money that we were putting into the business. And obviously not all businesses are able to be successful right off the bat, and ours certainly, I wouldn't call it successful in any department, only because we weren't profiting, right? We were barely breaking even. But as the years continued, as we started to hire people, get more vehicles, that trend kind of continued. Okay, we're still not profitable, but hey, at least we're breaking even. At least we're pushing on to the next year. At least we're staying in business. At least we're figuring out more ways to how to stay busy in the wintertime, right? Besides Snowmageddon, when it's 60, 70 degrees and beautiful outside, how do we stay busy with that? How do we keep more employees during that period of time? How do we extend our customer base and add more things that we can offer them? So all of those things, that they invested in me. They invested in Gold Eagle, in not only their time and energy, but with that monetary amount. And that would be the only way that we were able to jump off, unless there were some real hard years. Obviously my dad being in the office and having that very analytical engineer mind, he's looking at the numbers, he's crunching those numbers every day and showing, okay, we have to adjust our prices if we want to take better care of our customers. We can't just be the lowest totem, right? We can't be the lowest price out there, because anyone can be the lowest price. It's, are they going to be in business 2, 3, 4, 5 years, 30 years down the line to still serve those same customers? And so once we started to learn, some of those other business techniques, and CEO Warrior, which has been an amazing mentor towards us, those were the type of processes that we had to start to develop to become a profitable company and to keep growing and do all the wonderful things that a small company can do.
So the technique that Teresa used to get some funding for you was the modified whole life, that she is an ex she's an absolute expert in that, and also she's used it herself. It's a proven strategy. Did you have any misgivings about going that way, or did you immediately see the value of it? Do you understand the process as well as she does with that vehicle? And how do you feel about that?
Well, I don't know if anyone knows that vehicle as well as Teresa. At least before this journey, I think I had maybe understood it a little bit more. My focus and time and energy has been on Gold Eagles for the last 5 years. So, at least once I'm able to put more processes in place and more employees in place to kind of be able to have a little bit more free time, that's certainly something that I'm going to dive into more and, talk to Teresa about and invest more of my time in that, because, I certainly trust her and the things that she does, and the way that she's, made clients and kept clients is something that, not a lot of people are able to do, right? And so I think once it comes to that point, there's going to be a much stiffer learning, growth in that way as well.
She gets great reviews. You also get great reviews. I wanted to give you some kudos on that, because I go in there and I read those reviews from time to time, and you're definitely keeping the customer in the forefront. It's all about them and what they need, and people recognize that, and they're willing to pay a premium for that kind of service and that kind of passion. And you're just getting all kinds of really rave reviews about how clean you leave the job site. And I guess you don't even know until you hear people's stories with other HVAC companies that people, there's a lot of difference between the top and the bottom, and different crews do different things not so well. They don't clean up, they just track in stuff. And so I'm hearing, oh, their Keating was so polite, and you know, they cleaned up after themselves. So that's great. And it's the same kind of things I hear about your mom. It's like, again, the focus is on the client and meeting their needs and all that sort of stuff. Now, as far as the policies are concerned, one of these days, I think you're going to sit down, if you're like most people, and look at these things and think, oh my gosh, I saved so much interest that I would have had to pay on a business loan if I'd gotten it from a bank. Because really, certainly, what are your options when you start a company like this? I mean, in your mind, if you went to, you'd have to go to a private investor, maybe private money, or mm-hmm. you'd have to go to a bank and then jump through all kinds of hoops and, you know, stand on one leg for an hour until they decide whether or not you're worthy of their money.
Right.
And you'd have to, they'd be pressuring you all the time for results. They'd be, the investors would be pressuring you. So using this policy, I think, saved you a ton of money.
Of course,
to put back into the business. I think that's one of the best things about using whatever she's calling it now, the 100-year policy or the bank on yourself policy or whatever you want to call it. It's very powerful, because as you're spending your money, you're getting your money replaced. I mean, it's like you have $5 for every $1 that you're actually putting into it. So I think that's amazing that you use that kind of method to start funding your business. And as far as, you know, I know you have a lot of things going on. What is your function now within the company? You know, now that you've got things a little more settled, what is it that you are doing? What's your focus?
Yeah, on the day-to-day, you know, it's talking with every guy in the field and on every call that they're on. You know, I try to stay as on top of, you know, every single call and customer interaction that I can. You know, at this point, it's transitioned a little bit once you know, some of our newer employees have learned and adopted that the systems and processes that we have in place. You know, doing things on a daily basis, you know, looking at numbers to, you know, make sure that we're in line for our targets, and then talking with, you know, either other business owners or, you know, some coaches that we have to make sure that, you know, we're still staying on the right path for the targets that we're trying to achieve. I think that's, you know, that's the most important part, right? You can always go blindly through the day-to-day. You can just have your guys running about and kind of doing whatever they need to do to get through that day. Or you can be a little bit more on top of them on each call, each customer interaction that they have, because that's the way to make sure that every customer that we interact with is going to leave with a good taste in their mouth, right? And call us back the next time that they're going to have an issue.
What I was going to ask you to end this up, I know that working in Texas has its own unique set of challenges. Mm-hmm. It's a very interesting place. You know, Texas itself is a weird state, and you live in a weird city in a weird state. What is the strangest, most challenging case that you've had yet, situation that you've had to deal with as far as putting a unit in or fixing a unit or whatever? I know there's all kinds of critters, so it might be critter related.
Certainly critters. You know, obviously we run into houses with very tight access for HVAC. You know, we'll have some interesting interactions with homeowners. We'll have some interesting places that, you know, contractors or builders have decided to put units. I would say, you know, the craziest things that we really come across is mold, just the amount of mold that we find on a daily basis. You know, people that are living in houses that they don't even know what's going on. They have a certain amount of health related issues that they either go to a specialist of, or, you know, they do an at home mold test and figure out, wow, I do have a lot of mold in my house. Right. I think that's really the strangest thing that we find. And, you know, Austin in the past couple of years has turned more to an environment, at least in the summertime, like Houston. So we do have a lot more moisture in the air. And I think a lot of residents of different states, I won't name those states, but different states that have decided to move their family and their home
okay,
to Austin.
Okay, we're going to say it, because I see them leaving every day.
Absolutely,
I'm out,
yes.
I'm out in California and they're heading that way.
Well,
paying $5,000 for a U-Haul now just to get out of here.
exactly. And you know, a certain amount of the HVAC isn't as needed in California as it is here, right? And so they may not understand the necessity of having a system that can, you know, pull more moisture out of the air than your average system, you know, and we can kind of talk up those sorts of things as soon as they move here. But if they're moving here in the fall and the spring, they're not feeling it. And so, you know, some of our clients have moved in. We've really talked to them in depth about why, you know, taking humidity out of the house is important. And by that mid-summer point, you know, they finally realized, oh my God, I have, you know, very high humidity in the house. I have blinds or clothes or shoes that are starting to smell a little bit more mildewy. Exactly. So I would say that's the overarching theme for the last couple of years that we've really just run across on a day-to-day basis that, you know, we've had to train our guys and, you know,
Train your
how to
customers.
train our customers as well, absolutely. But you know, a certain amount of that after they experience it one, two, three times, they start to train themselves as well. It's training our guys how to handle those situations, and
It's
especially
like
when
no metal French doors. They don't get it, but now they know.
exactly. And you know, it's to give our guys a little bit of compassion as well, right? If we're opening a system or a ductwork on a daily basis and seeing, you know, some of the things that we see on a daily basis, there's, you know, we kind of tune it out. Right. And so when we bring it to a customer's attention, we certainly want to make it a point to, you know, have some compassion for what they're going through because it is their home at the end of the day, right? That's their nest that they live in, that they have their family in, where they spend, you know, 10 plus hours a day in that home. So, you know, just reassuring them that we can take care of it and that, you know, all will be well at the end of the day is certainly something that we have to continually strive for.
It's good. Are you finding too, as we wrap up here, as the economy is starting to sort of, I mean, it's different in different places. Are people putting off their maintenance a lot more? Are you seeing that people are like, oh man, I need to do it, but I'm gonna try not to do it because it's too expensive? Or seeing any of that?
You know, we really make it a point just because we believe in it that, you know, the maintenance is especially for a machine as important as your AC system or your furnace. You know, we really make it a point, and you know, at the end of the day, we have many options to keep their price, you know, as low as possible as necessary to make sure that they can afford it because, you know, your twice annual tune-up is so vitally important for the lifespan of your system and just to make sure that it is taking out the proper amount of moisture, right? That it is going to fire up when it is 28 degrees outside. If of course you have power to your home, you know, that it is going to fire up and work properly when you need it
Oh,
most.
was that shade you were throwing at us or something different? Yeah,
Well,
okay.
and it might have
Well.
been some shade that we were throwing at our own city because we certainly, you know, during that time, we certainly ran into a certain amount of those problems here as well. So, you know, just making sure that, you know, your system is optimized before a long stretch of time that you're going to be using it for, you know, really making sure that, hey, are your insulation levels proper? You know, are there anything in the ductwork or anything that we need to, you know, focus on and take care of before you know, don't see us for a certain amount of time. So I wouldn't say that we've had a drop off. We've certainly increased our memberships. And we've certainly increased our happy customers. So sometimes I just refuse to participate in the some of the things that the news says. If you focus on something, it becomes very big, right? And so if you decide not to focus on something or to focus your attention elsewhere, you know, you can certainly create your own future that way.
You know, I want to mention again the name. If you live in the Austin, how far out do you go? What's your service area right now?
Oh yeah, we'll go to all the surrounding cities in Austin. So all the way up to Round Rock, we'll go to Del Valle, all the way down to Kyle. So it's a pretty big service area.
Good. It's Gold Eagle Services. They are on the internet all over the place. And you can reach out to Keating and connect with him. The most important thing I want you to walk, you know, take away today, ladies and gentlemen, is that there are alternatives to college, number one. You don't have to get $200,000 or $300,000 in debt to be successful. And number two, you can harness the power of these types of policies, these specially modified dividend paying, you know, whole life policies, and use them to fund a business, a home, investment. I mean, your mother also, I forgot to mention that your mother also got you to buy the house where you were operating out of. Was that it?
That
So you
correct?
actually owned, instead of leasing an office building for your, you know, you were actually able to write off a lot of stuff because you had a total home office. and you're getting the equity on it. And that was a really smart move. I don't know who thought of that, but kudos to them for thinking of that. And there's just so many things you can do. So thanks a lot to Keating Kuhn, Teresa's one and only. And I know she's extremely proud of you. I'm proud of you too. I think you've really done a great job with this company, and I can't wait to see you nationwide. This is my vision. Indeed. Gonna have gold eagles in every state, except maybe California, because they hate business here. So you're not gonna be able to come here, but maybe other states you can do. So for the Safe Space Podcast, I'm Tammy DeLue. This is Keating Kuhn. Thank you so much, Keating. And I will be getting back to you with something to approve for a little forward for the new book your mom is writing. Did you know you're going to be an author too? So
yes,
take care.
Thank you very much, Tammy.
We will talk soon. Thanks so much. God bless. Take care.
Yes, ma'am.
You've done it. You've faced the fear and triumphed. Thanks for listening to the Safe Space Podcast with Tammy D. For episode information or to suggest a guest or topic, go to saferpodcast.com.